There is a simple strategic mistake that guys continue to make, which means that they will not get a second date with a girl. Have you ever had that experience where you go on a first date with a girl and it goes well? The chemistry is good, she clearly likes you, but for whatever reason, you cannot get her to come out on a second date. She doesn't respond, she doesn't seem keen, she's always got excuses, or she flakes on you. There's actually a very simple solution to this once you understand where you're going wrong. First off, this is assuming that the first date actually went well. If you were really awkward and needy on the first date and you didn't generate any attraction, well, that's why you're not getting a second date. This video is not going to help you. But if the vibe was good, but you're still not getting that second date, then my guess is that the reason you're not getting that next date is because you're trying to coordinate it over text. Texting is inherently awkward and men are at a massive disadvantage. To type little cute messages and to use emojis is just not masculine. Texting is primarily a female behavior. And if you don't believe me, just think of your sister or female friends that you have and compare the number of texts that you send in a day to the number of texts that they send. If you took the total number of texts that were sent across the world and you divided them by gender, I guarantee you'd find the overwhelming majority of them were sent by women. The only time that men really send a lot of texts is when they're chatting to a woman and they're trying to generate attraction. But that's the problem. Because in addition to men being less practiced at the medium of texting, it is almost impossible to generate any emotions or attraction over text, and emotions and attraction are what you need to get that second date. You may have had a fantastic first date. She was feeling emotional, she had butterflies, she felt this primal attraction to you, and that spending time with you was like being on an emotional roller coaster. She was high. But like all highs, it wears off and it becomes difficult to remember what it felt like. Now, after the date, when she receives that text from you, it's a little neurological reminder, like a notification that goes off in her brain, and it's like, ah, yes, that's that guy that made me feel all of those emotions. The memory that's been triggered by your text gives her a small taste of those same emotions. Hear me when I say that at that point, you are on borrowed time. The impact of your text message is riding on the borrowed emotional energy that you generated the last time that you saw her in person. She is living off that memory, and it's only going to last so long. Memories fade, that's what they do, and as intense as the emotions were that she felt, the attraction that she felt when she was face to face with you in person, that's going to drop off naturally over time. Each new notification that she gets reminding her of you through these texts is going to have less and less impact as you are burning through the reservoir of emotional energy that you built up in the first date. So what happens when you have completely depleted all of these reserves by going back and forth over text? By the time that you get round to actually asking for that second date, she's forgotten how she felt about you. At that point, she will be using a completely different set of emotions to make her decision whether or not to see you again. Let's just zoom out for a second. Us human beings, we like to think of ourselves as rational creatures, but in truth, humans in general, and women in particular, make our decisions emotionally. In practical terms, what this means is that when you ask her for that second date, she's likely to either say yes or no based on her emotions right then in that moment. If she gets your text asking for that second date when she's in a great mood because she's had an amazing day, things have gone really well for her, then she's gonna likely say yes because she wants to keep those good vibes going. But if she gets your text when she's in a depressed mood and she's had an awful day and nothing has gone right for her, she's likely to say no because she just feels like rejecting things in that moment. What sucks, like the absolute tragedy of it, is that in both situations, she liked you. On the first date, she had a good time, but because you left it to texting, you basically ceded all control over her emotional state when answering this next question, when she's going to see you. Now, some guys think that they can generate emotions, they can generate attraction over text. You know, some flirtatious comments, some witty banter, some compliments, some interesting questions. Admittedly, some guys do have good text game. That is a skill that you can learn. But for most guys, whenever they're sending all these texts to a woman, trying to generate emotions, trying to generate attraction, what they're actually doing is just burning through all of the reserves of positive emotional energy that they generated the last time they saw them in person. It's a losing game because they cannot build positive emotions faster than they're depleting them. It's not their fault, it's just the limitation of the medium. It's hard to generate attraction over text. It's hard to maintain frame over text. All of the evolutionary triggers that make a woman attracted to a man are all hardwired specifically for in-person interactions. They didn't have texting back in caveman days, but they did have things like tone of voice, body language, laughter, touch, just the general vibe of you, even pheromones. It's all done face to face. And so when she's in front of you, even if she can't cognitively explain it because it's not rational, she knows when she feels attraction to someone. So texting sucks. Straight up, it just sucks. You might have enough goodwill and positive emotions generated from the last in-person interaction that you had to get away with it, but it still sucks. So what do you do then? How do you ask somebody for a second date? The answer is that you do it while on the first date. You need to go into the first date with a plan for the second. A place that you want to visit, a concert that you want to go to, a restaurant that you want to try, whatever suits your vibe. Go into the first date with a set concrete plan for the second. And do not wait until the end of the date to ask for that second one. The right time to ask is when the first date is at its emotional peak. That moment when you know that she's having a good time, she's laughing, she's having fun. There's heaps of positive energy in the air and you're confident that she's feeling super attracted to you. Don't let that moment go to waste. What you need to do is leverage all of those positive emotions to socially lubricate the awkwardness of coordinating for a second date. You finish telling a joke and she's laughing and she's making the eyes at you. She's really attracted to you. It's on. It's at that moment that you say, "By the way, while it's on my mind, I've got this cool thing that I want to do sometime. Do you want to join me for that?" You are basically guaranteed a yes, because at that moment when you asked, that's when she's feeling peak attraction for you. Right then and there, she's feeling amazing and she wants those positive emotions to keep on flowing. When she's at that emotional high, she's basically going to say yes to anything that you suggest, within reason. But here's another tip. Make sure that you get her to agree to the abstract idea of the date before you start going into the specifics. It's really dangerous to offer a second date with something specific like, "Are you free next Saturday at 7 p.m? Because if she is genuinely busy that night, then she needs to say no to your date, which is not good for your frame. And if you say, "Oh, well, how about Sunday? How about Monday? How about Tuesday?" It's not a good look. So first you get her to agree to the date in the abstract. And once you're both committed to that, it's a lot easier to just pull out your calendars and coordinate a time that suits you both. By doing it like this, by taking the initiative and being masculine, sorting it out like it's a fait accompli, you are actually doing her a favor. Women like a man who takes charge, who is assertive and shows leadership. Now, I did have one guy in my private consultations who objected to this tactic, to this timing, because he felt that it could be manipulative. His concern was that if you ask for a second date while in the middle of the first date, isn't she going to be socially obligated to say yes because she doesn't want the rest of the date to be awkward? That is a legitimate concern, because women in that circumstance would have a hard time saying no. And it is manipulative to pressure a woman into saying yes to something when you know that she's just being polite. She would rather say no. But that's not what I'm talking about here. I'm not advocating that you ask for that second date when the vibe is bad. If it's obvious that she isn't enjoying herself, don't pressure her for a second date. You're just using her politeness against her. That's a dick move. This is only to be used when you know that she likes you, when the vibe is good. At that point, it's not manipulative, it's just a strategic decision that you're making to lessen the awkwardness of trying to coordinate this over text. Texting, asking questions, coordinating dates, that's awkward for both you and her, and by being assertive and sorting this out in person, you're making it less awkward for both of you. When you know that she likes you, you can tell that she wants to have that second date. Doing it like this is doing her a favor. It's confident, it's masculine, and it just makes practical sense. So then why don't people do this more often? Why do people have a good first date and then leave it at that and just wait until they're home and they can text in order to coordinate the second one? Mostly it's because they fear rejection. They don't want that situation where they're face to face with a woman and she says, "No, sorry, I'm not interested," because that's going to hurt so much. So what they do is they wait until they're at the safe distance of texting, where they can hide behind their phone screen and the woman doesn't actually need to see the shame and embarrassment that they feel when they get rejected. But doing it like that is planning for failure. It's not very masculine. And practically speaking, it increases the likelihood that you're going to get rejected. But the sad truth is that a lot of guys are more scared by failure than they are motivated by success. And they become victims of their own lack of courage. Let me end by saying this. High quality women are rare, and men pursuing them are abundant. If you want to have a chance, if you want to stand out, then you need to demonstrate a masculinity and a courage that 90% of men don't have. An exceptional life will only come to those men who are willing to take the risks necessary to be exceptional. So don't do what's easy, do what's hard, because what's hard is what's necessary. You must be willing to risk rejection. Trust me, your future self will thank you. What are the rules in the modern age for a boy's initiation into manhood? Exactly how much ambition should a man have? And when is the right time for a man to consider dating women from developing countries? All of these topics and many more are covered in exclusive videos available to my Patreon. This includes my latest video, Is It Ever a Good Idea to Date a Woman Who Has an Instagram Account with Sexy Pictures in It? In this video, I talk about the positives of social media use and to what degree they're encouraging femininity. And I also talk about the dangers of social media use, things like addiction and the requirement for validation. I talk about the difference between taking beautiful photos and sexy photos, and all of the reasons why you need to be suspicious of a woman who has sexy photos on her social media accounts, and the kind of conversations you need to have. Lastly, I debunk the common feminist misconceptions that would paint your objections as patriarchal and explain why they don't apply in a romantic relationship and why an OnlyFans account is a non-negotiable red flag. Never go there. If you're dating a woman who has an Instagram account or you're interested in dating an influencer, I highly recommend you check out this video. For every video that I post here on YouTube, I post an additional bonus video on my Patreon page. That means that at the moment, you're only seeing half of the total content that I create. If you would like access to the other half, then please go and sign up at my Patreon page. It's just a $5 a month subscription, and you get instant access to a whole bunch of exclusive content. It's a wonderful way to support the channel, and I would love to see you over there.